Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our CloudyCluster and Google Cloud Platform overview for the HPC in the City Dallas Hackathon that is linked with Supercomputing 22 that is starting, oh my goodness, tomorrow. Yes. So it's going to be a fun day. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and share a few bits of information with everyone on the call. Just do a bit of an overview for you. And then we're going to hand it over to our presenter today, who is actually Cole McKnight from Omnibond. I want to make sure, is everybody able to see the screen in full screen ahead of you and no gray bars or any of that good stuff? Perfect. Perfect. All right. So having said that, again, welcome to everyone. Today's agenda. We're going to go over a couple of objectives and student outcomes. That way, everyone is aware of what's expected of them, some information about our students, deliverables and resources, and then we will jump right into our CloudyCluster and Google Cloud Platform overview. Having said that, if you have not joined our Discord server, please take a moment to scan this QR code or click the link when I share that online so that you too can play the home game, or most importantly, you can actually connect with your teams and mentors throughout the event. Now, the objective of HPC in the City is to bring together the resources, skills, knowledge, talents that's found within the high performance computing community. Computing community in order to address problems and issues that are related to local regional areas. In this case, we're looking at the Dallas and greater state of Texas areas are target for this particular hackathon. Some of the student outcomes include increased familiarity with data science in the cloud, experiencing collaborative software engineering, which if you have ever done that, it's interesting. And of course, develop some professional communication skills, all while actually being able to work with vendors and specialists in the field. Now, just to kind of give you an idea of a project timeline, generally what happens is tomorrow at the cookout, I wish it was a doc, we should have a cookout for our kickoff. But no, tomorrow for our kickoff, you're going to have mentors that come out and they offer pitches. Those pitches are going to last at maximum 2 minutes, and they're going to have one slide. Then you, as participants, will be able to pick which project you want to work on with your feet. You actually go to whichever breakout room you find interesting so that you can work on it. During the project, over the course of the project, we'll have check-ins, two check-ins daily so that we can make sure that everyone is making progress. If there are any issues that you have, we can, of course, assist you with. And this is the first time I get to say it to you, which I'm excited about. We're family in during our hackathons. Even though there is a little bit of a competition there, we're here to help each other. We're all here to learn. And so if one team figures out something, we may have them present to the group so that they can help everyone, because we're a family and we're building our networks. And then of course, you'll have your final presentations on Monday, November 7th, where you'll present your presentation saying what you've done, what you've accomplished, and show a demo that goes along with it. And now along with that, there are some deliverables we're gonna ask about, but I'll show you that here in a moment. As far as in the competition component, there are three awards that we give out, three primary awards. The first one is the judge's choice, and we have the metrics for selecting a winner there, including project impact, viability and usefulness, creativity of execution, the UI, so how and polish, how well it looks, the technical complexity, collaboration of the group, presentation and completeness. Now, I want you to know that the most complex of the projects may not necessarily win. The easiest of the projects may not necessarily win, but that is, of course, up to our judges, and they do allow for that. But outside of that, we also have our Viewer's Choice Award, where you'll be able to send out a link and have people vote for your team. And then our Impact Award, which will focus directly on which project is would be most impactful for the Dallas and greater state of Texas area. Now, the deliverables, these are the things that as a team, you kind of have to get in your mind and be prepared for them. Your team will create a GitHub repository. And on that repository, you'll, of course, put your source code, including comments, a PDF of the presentation with team members, pictures, use of HPC technology in the project, and the project impact on the community. You'll also edit and customize your readme.md. Now, for any of you all that are not familiar with GitHub, that is perfectly fine. We actually have a training session tomorrow that will go over both Discord and GitHub. GitHub basics in order to make sure that you have the tools and things you need in order to get going. Some of the resources available to you, we have been graciously supported by Google, who have provided cloud credits. So you will have access to the Google Cloud platform, which Cole will actually be going over a little bit today. You'll actually get to see it a bit. CloudyCluster. Some of the more commonly used languages include Python, and services including Jupyter Notebooks, Node.js, Replit, which is a collaborative programming environment. If you are a CS major and you have not seen Replit, REPL.IT, take a look. When you're doing these group projects, you'll be surprised how much that site will help. And of course, HTML and Discord is of course here for communications. Now, if there are any chats, I am in full screen. So I cannot see them. So let me go ahead and open that, make sure I am okay. All right, good. We're good. So having said that, I get to close my mouth and I get the pleasure to hand the floor over to Mr. Cole McKnight of the CloudyCluster project from Omnibon. Now I'm going to go ahead and escape this and stop my share. And I would like to welcome to the stage Cole, but before I do, I just want to make sure, are there any questions? Now, I do see, will pandas be available? Now, Pat, of course, pandas, for those of you that may not be aware of that, pandas is a library inside of Python that allows you to do certain things. And the answer to that is yes, Pat, as well as any other library you may want to use or module you'd like to use in Python, you're welcome to use it. You can, of course, add it. So having said that, are there any other questions? We got a thumbs up. We got nods. Then in that case, Cole, the floor is yours.
Hey guys. So first off, I'd just like to start by thanking everyone for being here, or if you're listening to the recording, thank you for taking the time to do that. The main thing is, you're really doing something for yourself here, because this training, knowing how to use a distributed cluster, like an HPC cluster, will obviously put you pretty far ahead in an HPC hackathon. We have some teams use CloudyCluster, and some teams use kind of a serial computing things like a Jupyter Notebook, for example. There have been teams that have won using Jupyter Notebooks or just other just serial tech, serial computing environments, meaning you only have one computer doing one thing at a time. That's, as Jamie said before, those teams can still win. You don't have to use CloudyCluster, but it will put you ahead. The judges really do look at that, look at the fact that you took the time to watch this and to learn about how to use a distributed cluster like CloudyCluster. The other thing is that it will really help you further in your HPC career, because using CloudyCluster is as close as we could possibly make it to using your campus's HPC cluster, using a national lab's HPC cluster. It uses the same scheduler and a lot of the very same similar mechanics as basically any HPC cluster that you'll kind of encounter later on in your career. So anyways, thanks for showing up. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. The basic agenda today is I'm going to show you how to access CloudyCluster. And then I'm going to show you how to install custom software, or basically we'll show you how to access CloudyCluster just like you will in the hackathon, and then show you how to use it, and then show you how to install custom software like pandas. I think we already have pandas, but we'll try that. I'm going to do a molecular simulation package called LAMPS that is commonly used in the HPC community. We might do pandas as a little thing. I think it's like pip-m install pandas or something. We'll see if we already have it, just because it's only one command. Okay. So starting with what is CloudyCluster? What does it look like? This is a simplified image of an HPC cluster. You can see that you have a laptop, which is your computer. That's what you're using. And you're using something called SSH, or there's also an in-browser method of accessing something called the login node, okay? Your login node is the node that you interact with. It's where you submit jobs from. It's where you enter in commands. It's basically, that's what the node that you're gonna be using. This node is a virtual machine, which is basically just a virtual computer that is sitting in Google Cloud. So once again, you have your laptop using the login node, and then you have your, let me see if I can move this, there we go. You have your queue. So what is a queue? So when you submit a job, that job goes in a queue, and it basically gets assigned to a compute node. What CloudyCluster does is it basically, when a job is submitted, it'll look at the job and say, okay, what compute nodes do we need to create to make this happen? It creates the compute nodes, runs your job, and then destroys the compute nodes. That's one of the really major differences between CloudyCluster and a traditional HPC cluster, is CloudyCluster is actually creating the nodes on the fly and then destroying them after the job is done. So you're actually not paying for those nodes to just be sitting around unused. That's kind of one of the major issues in traditional HPC clusters, is there are millions and millions of dollars of hardware that sometimes just sit around unused. The final kind of piece of this is shared storage, because these compute nodes and login nodes need to be able to access the same files. If you have an input file, for example, and you have multiple jobs needing to access that input file, that's what the shared storage is. So login node, compute node, shared storage. Any questions on that, about the basics of what a HPC cluster is?
Yes, I did want to make sure with that HPC cluster, I keep hearing about this word node. So what is a node?
Oh, thanks. So these nodes are virtual machines, which are basically virtual computers. In a traditional HPC cluster, they would be servers. So you'd have a big server rack, just like this picture right here, that has all these computers in it. And these are the nodes of that cluster. All this fancy looking stuff these are the actual nodes of an on-premise, that's what you call a cluster that's local to a certain area. These are the nodes of an on-premise cluster. Ours are VMs existing in the cloud. And I'll show you that in a second. I'll show you what the nodes are and what they look like in the cloud as well. But then you can basically look at nodes as a computer that's doing work for you. Any other questions? Cool. Okay. Well, we're going to continue then. So the first thing when you get into the hackathon, probably tomorrow, actually, there's going to be, everyone's going to form teams, and there's going to be a bunch of clusters that are already created in Google Cloud. And you're going to give me, or actually you'll just, each team will get basically a username and a password for their cluster to log into it. Now, there's some things that you'll need to actually use the cloud console. And for that, you could just give me your Gmail account and I can add you to the console and you can do what I'm about to show you as far as creating a custom image to use. So I'm gonna show real quick basically a list of instances that we have up. This is one of our larger projects. Yours is not gonna look like this, but this is a list of VMs. So if you go to the VM instances, this is how you can see the nodes of your cluster. But you're gonna get your username and your password and you're gonna log in to, I'll go ahead and log in here. So when you click, when you get your URL for your cluster, and you're gonna click this, which is just standard username, password, login. So I'm probably gonna make student or hacker or something like that. And when you log in to CloudyCluster, you're gonna see this page, okay? So there's overview, which is basically looking at your cluster. There's a dashboard, which is performance stuff, which you don't need to really worry about. There's access, which is how you access different parts of different services that we provide, like open on demand, and I'll go over that in a little bit. Collaborations, you really don't need to worry about any of this other stuff, unless you're trying to do administration stuff, which you're probably not going to do. But let's click on overview and look at our cluster. So some of this might already seem a little bit familiar based on that picture that I showed earlier. So you have a login node. So this is a computer that is that's the one you're gonna access and run commands on. So that's your login node. You have a scheduler node, which is something a little bit special to CloudyCluster. There's definitely on-prem clusters that also have scheduler nodes, but this is basically a node that just takes your jobs in and then runs the necessary Google commands to create your nodes and then destroy them when the job is done. And then you have your control instance, which is the VM, the computer that is hosting this overview page. That's the control node. That's what we're looking at. We're looking at a service hosted on the control node right now. You have parallel storage, and then you have networking stuff that connects everything. I'm gonna show you basically how to access the login node. So to access the login node, you can click terminal. I would not recommend it. It doesn't allow you to copy and paste. So I'm not even gonna go over that. Just if for some reason you want to, you could get a terminal in browser here. The way I recommend to access CloudyCluster is by hitting the access tab. You can then click something called open on demand. And you have to enter in your username and password. So open on demand is it's a software platform, I guess, that makes using an HPC cluster a lot easier. It's used at a lot of different universities. Places have this installed on their clusters. And people just across the community really like it. That's why we decided to integrate Open On Demand with CloudyCluster to make it easier for people to use CloudyCluster, just like they would normally be using their on-premise HPC cluster. So you go, hit Access tab, go here, all right? There's a couple different parts to Open On Demand. There's a file system browser. There's looking at jobs. You can try to learn this, but just for the hackathon, it might be easier just to submit jobs from the login node. So I'm not gonna go over this right now because of time. If you really care about using the job composer, let me know and I'll meet with you separately. but I would just submit jobs to the login node, like I'll show you in a second. There's clusters, which is what we're about to do to access our login node. And then we finally have desktops, which is basic or interactive apps. So the two interactive apps that we offer is a Cloudy desktop and a Jupyter server. So this is an easy way if you don't have an HPC job that needs to run in parallel, but you still want to use CloudyCluster, which will give you points with the judges and just allow you to use an HPC cluster. This is what I would do. I would use a Cloudy desktop, which is an actual interactive like graphical user interface, meaning that like it's a an actual, you get a desktop and everything. If you need to do visualizations or something, this is a great app to do it. And then you have your Jupyter notebook, which is just basically a Python or something similar server. We're gonna go ahead and start both of these now so that we can continue with things. Cloudy desktop, these are all the basics. We're not gonna mess with it. So we're gonna launch a desktop app. So I can show you all that later. And then we're also gonna launch a Jupyter notebook. And so once again, these are the easiest ways to use CloudyCluster. If you don't have, let's say your team comes up with a really cool project, but it doesn't use parallel computing, that's fine. You can still use CloudyCluster by these interactive apps. But what's preferred and what's more HPC, in my opinion, is parallel computing, where you have multiple computers doing the work for you. So we're gonna go ahead and get on the login node. So go ahead and type yes when you get to the screen, and then your password one more time. And of course, you're gonna be provided with passwords. Okay, so this is called a bash terminal, if none of you have seen this before. This is basically a command line interface. It's called a command line interface where you can enter in commands and they're run on your computer. If you're used to seeing a graphical user interface like this, like, you know, where you have, you know, internet browsers and different deals, annoying McAfee warnings. Anyways, this is kind of the other and more traditional way of using a computer. You can basically enter in commands and those commands will show you how to, or those commands will do a lot of stuff. A lot of people prefer using a CLI. I prefer using a CLI for a lot of cases. And so you can do things like ls, which is list the current files in your directory. You can do cd, which is go to a current directory. But what we're gonna do now, I'll go ahead and stop for questions, but we're about to go and submit a sample job with CloudyCluster. So I'm gonna stop though. Is there any questions about what I've just gone over? So the structure of CloudyCluster, what open on demand is, how I got here, any questions? Okay, cool. I think that's a good thing. we're gonna go ahead and submit a job to CloudyCluster. And then after that, I'll show you how to add custom software. And if we have time, we'll run a job using that custom software. And if someone wants to really quickly figure out a command to install pandas, I think it's pip-m install pandas. That would be nice. I was gonna do a different piece of software, but because someone asked, it's just a one command thing, very easy.
Yep, that's it. Pip install -m pandas.
Cool. Okay. Yeah, anyways, that's ahead of things. So what I'm gonna do is, so how CloudyCluster works is this is your login node. A very important thing to know, probably the most important thing to know right now, is how to access shared storage. Because you want all of your nodes, your computers, to be able to access the same files in a lot of cases. So this is something that works for all computers, not just CloudyCluster, but there's a directory called mount, okay? And once again, this is how you get, so CD is change directory. So you get to this mount folder. If you LS, so that's list, I don't really know what the S stands for, but list, you know, list files or list folders. You can see that there we have something called OrangeFS, okay? That is the distributed file system that CloudyCluster uses. You might have heard of stuff, something called LusterFS or PVFS. Or you might have heard of, there's a lot of different parallel file systems out there. NFS is an example that you might have heard of. We use something called OrangeFS, which is a very similar to PVFS. It's not important for you to know any of that. What is important is that you know that you know how to get to the shared storage. So anything inside this OrangeFS folder is going to be usable by all of your nodes. All of your nodes can see anything after this mount OrangeFS. So so we have only one folder in here, and that's just your default user. So you can see that I'm student, and that's why there's a student folder. That's our default user's shared folder. Let's say this is a command to make a directory. So maybe we can call it like input files. And then we can go ahead and list again to make sure it's there. Okay, so you can create as many directories as you want, put as many files as you want. They all need to be in Mount OrangeFS for all the computers to see them, okay? All your nodes to see them. So that's very important. That's a very important thing for CloudyCluster is that you understand how to get to the shared storage. Anyways, what we're gonna do is we're gonna copy,
Could you do a PWD real quick? Print working directory, thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. So what that command does is it prints out your current directory. So if you don't know where you are, you can just type in PWD and it will tell you what to do. Another really quick bash tip is if you want to save, it helps me like a lot. If you want to go to, if you want to complete something without typing it out, you can use tab. So like you can just type in I and just tab and it'll save you a ton of time. Anyways, that I'm getting off topic, but that's just something that saves me a ton of time. But anyways, what we're gonna do is we're gonna copy a sample job that we have on our nodes into this shared storage, and then we're gonna run it. So I'm gonna go cp-r, that means you can copy entire folders with the R flag, it's called a flag. Our software is in software, sample jobs, MPI, GCP, because we're on GCP and not AWS. We'll just do sample jobs. I forgot. Yeah. So that's your source. And then your destination is Mount OrangeFS student. Okay, so we're gonna go into that directory. So mount OrangeFS student sample jobs, MPI, GCP. see how easy, I mean, I'm just hitting tab. That makes it very easy to go where I wanna go because I just hit tab every time. Anyways, so we have a couple scripts in here. One is to compile our MPI job, and the other is to actually submit it to our scheduler node, which is going to create GCP instance, or I think it'll actually create two GCP instances. It'll run our job on those, and then it'll tear them down. So first, we're going to use something called Nano. Nano is a text editor. That's how you actually can edit the text in your files. There's also a really cool one that I'll show you. So if you go to the files, where are files? So if we go to files, let me refresh this so that we can see our software. So another really easy way, if you don't want to use Nano, because Nano is kind of basic, you can go into MPI and you can go, let's see. Oh wait, I just print the file. You want to go to edit. So this is a really nice feature because typically you're used to having to do CMPI prime compile. So this is your typical thing, and it's kind of clunky. You can't do copy and paste. You can't do anything. I mean, well, you can do copy and paste, but you can't like do like multi-line selects and like this kind of clunky. This is a really nice way, a much nicer text to edit files. So we're going to go ahead and you can see that this is our compile script. So what this does is it compiles this MPI job. And it actually needs to be, I just realized, I need to put in a student right here. Student sample jobs MPI, perfect. And then I think Control S will work for this one, but I'll make sure by just hitting save. Oh, that's not what I wanted. That's also not what I wanted. And that's also not what I wanted. Okay, so don't do control S and this doesn't work. So you gotta hit save, I guess, looks like. So we're gonna save that, and then we're going to exit this text editor because we didn't need it anymore. What is this? Why did you freeze on me? Oh, that's right. Control X. No, I don't want that. Control C. Control X. There we go. Okay, and then we're going to run. So how you run commands is ./ and then MPI prime compile. And okay, so now we should have our nice little MPI prime. So that's the actual software that we compiled. Okay, so next up is we're going to actually run our job. So I'm just going to use nano this time. And this is mpiprime.sh. So this is called an HPC. This is an HPC job script. So you might recognize some things if you've ever used an HPC cluster, especially one that has that uses Slurm or PBS as a scheduler, because CloudyCluster uses the exact same schedulers that a lot of HPC clusters use. This is these right here are called job headers. So this SBatch line and this PBS line, this is how you tell the scheduler what you want to do, or what you want it to do. So like, for example, this line, we're going to use Slurm for this one. So we're going to uncomment one of those. They actually are supposed to have one hash behind them, but this header tells the scheduler to use two nodes. So N, capital N, and two means use two. I want two nodes for this. So I want two compute nodes. I want two computers. And this, it means I want two tasks per node. Okay. You can, easy way to make sure that you have everything correctly as far as nodes and tasks per node is whatever kind of parallel software you're using usually has a number of tasks, and the number of nodes times the number of tasks per nodes, if you multiply these, should equal the number of processes. So that's just an easy way. Yeah.
Let me straighten this out real quick because a bunch of terminology has just been thrown in. So I just want to say this for everyone. So Slurm is what's called a job scheduler. When you have a lot of nodes, so a lot of computers that are connected together, you need something to be able to talk between those different computers to keep track of these applications, these jobs that are running. Inside of each computer, you have these things. Well, actually not inside each computer, but inside each job, each application you want to run, they have tasks that you want to accomplish. These are little bits of things that can basically work independently for the most part. I know I am very much oversimplifying this. the combination of MPI, the message passing interface, or message passing interface is a programming language that allows those applications to talk across those different computers, those different nodes. So to put this all together, you write a program in MPI. So let's say something like you want to calculate the largest prime number there ever is. Don't do that, by the way. You want to calculate a Titanic prime number. You would want multiple computers to work on it at once. And so you would use this message passing interface, MPI, to write your code, compile it. And then you would create this job submission script, which you're looking at right now, that Cole's working on. And that job submission script would then run inside a job scheduler. And that's Slurm. That's the one that Cole was also talking about. The job scheduler then goes, hey, all these computer nodes that are connected to me, which one of you all are available for work? Mm-hmm. They come back and go, I am. And then the job scheduler goes, all right, and you get a task. And when you're done, let me know and we'll put it all back together. So that's kind of how everything works all together.
Cool. Thanks so much, Jamie. That was a really nice explanation. I realized I skipped over a lot of stuff. Are there any questions anyone else has about anything I've covered or what Jamie just said? I mean, you don't need to understand all the ins and outs of a message passing interface or yet, you know, if you want to use it for your hack, you can, but it's not like a base requirement. Any questions?
That's good. Cool. Nothing in chat.
Yep. Cool. Oh yeah. Sorry. Yeah. If someone else could look at chat, that would be very helpful because I'm not doing that. So we uncommented our Slurm job headers because we're going to use Slurm for this job. We're going to use these things called modules, and I'll actually cover modules in a second after I submit this job. But we're going to use the OpenMPI module. And then we're going to use this MPI exec command to run our job with four processes, because we have two nodes and two tasks per node. We're doing four processes. So with that being said, to submit jobs in CloudyCluster, there's a command called CCQ. That's what our scheduler is called, is CCQ. And there's different variations of CCQ that allow you to do different things. There's CCQ stat, which prints your jobs. So as you can see, we have two jobs that are running right now. That is our Jupyter. One of these is our Jupyter notebook that we submitted a little while ago, and the other is our desktop app that we submitted a little while ago. We're going to submit this MPI prime job. So to do that, there's CCQ sub. So the way you can remember is CCQ submit. So you're submitting a job. CCQ sub is submitting a job, and that's what we're going to do. So it expects a job script. And there's a lot of different flags. If you want to look at the flags, and this goes for pretty much any command, you can just do the dash H flag, or you know, dash dash help. And it'll tell you all these different ways, all these really cool things you can do to do this. And we're actually going to use one of the, we won't use one of these later. We'll use a job script header. But anyways, there's all these nice things you can do with this. So remember, if you ever need to, you're ever like curious of how to do something, just use the dash H flag. But anyways, so CCQ sub MPI prime dot SH. Okay, and you should get something like this. As long as you did everything correctly and, you know, didn't didn't like have something misconfigured as far as the job script headers or something. It should say the job has been successfully been submitted. Your job ID is that. Let's look at it in our CC key stat. So status, kind of, I think CC key status. And so as you can see, we have a job being that's in the pending state. It's gonna, and if you ever want to run a command you just ran, you just use the up arrow and down arrow to go through the commands you recently ran. Another nice little thing you can do is you can use watch CC key stat. And this basically will show a real time output of whatever command you run. It's not just for CC key stats, for any command, but it'll basically just run these commands over and over and over again. And so you can see, you don't have to keep running that command. So right now it's in the creating control group stage. That means it's creating those VMs, it's creating the compute nodes, it's creating compute group, not control group, but it's creating those compute nodes to do your work for it. And as you can see, we're using the scheduler. How you get out of this is just control C. Anyway, that's just an easy way that instead of having to just run CC key stat every time, you can monitor your jobs. While that's running, it shouldn't take very long. Most of the time it's gonna take is actually creating the nodes, but it might take 5 or 10 minutes to run. While we're there, we're gonna go ahead and I'll stop here for questions real quick. Is there any questions about what I just did as far as submitting the job or how I was monitoring the jobs?
So just to say it out loud one more time. So CCQ sub is to submit a job to run on all the cluster or a node, however many nodes you select on a cluster or however many computers you select on a cluster. And CCQ stat is a way for me to see if my job is running or done.
Yep.
Okay. Just making sure.
Yep. Nope, you're right. And there's one more called CCQ del, and that's deleting a job. And I'll show you that in a second whenever we're done accessing our Jupyter and Cloudy desktop instances, because we'll be done with those. Right at the start, when I accessed Open On Demand, I went to this interactive apps dropdown, and I created one of each of these things with the default settings. They were submitted and deployed, and you can view them in the My Interactive Sessions page. So let's go ahead and connect to Jupyter and connect to Cloudy Desktop. And so once again, this is a way to use CloudyCluster without having to do a lot of the parallel HPC stuff. I would say this is the baseline of what you should be doing. Once again, you don't have to use CloudyCluster, but at a very baseline, you should be able to run your code on one of these things, and that'll get you points, and that'll really help with stuff. And also, you can say that you use Open On Demand. It's very nice to use these apps as a very minimal thing to do, even if you don't have parallel code.
So I want to say this one more time for you all. So this is a big one. Cole said it. So of course, with your projects, you're expected to use some type of HPC technology. Firing up CloudyCluster and then running Jupyter Lab or Jupyter Notebooks qualifies. It qualifies for that. One thing I would like to, so also for those of you that have never heard of Jupyter Notebooks is a platform that allows you to use everything from Python to R to, well, we're going to see what's installed here because I don't want to give away the ship here. But the main thing that people generally use Jupyter for is to run Python applications interactively. But Cole, if you wouldn't mind, could you show them how you got to that Jupyter Notebook one more time? I'm sorry about that.
Yep. I went to My Interactive Sessions. And once again, how I created it is I went to My Interactive Apps and I selected Jupyter. And then once it was deployed, a My Interactive Sessions page showed up. And then I just hit connect to Jupyter. And it will show up right here. And you can do whatever. But yeah, this is what it looks like. As you can see, there's a lot of different things you can do with it. There's Python, there's Bash. I think there's different versions of the things. I'm not really, but anyways, there's a, you can see that there's a file browser right here. It's a very useful, and as you can see, it's the same file. So we're on a login node right now. You can see that there we have sample jobs that we can look into and mess with. So it's not a separate thing. We're able to access all of our files on the cluster. But if you want to do Python 3, let's do pip install -m pandas. I think I might just be using import pandas. Let's see if that'll work. Nope, it's maybe, I think I would just be doing import pandas.
Exclamation point. You need to add an exclamation point. At the front.
Where?
At the very front.
Right here?
Yep. Just add exclamation point. Yep. Now run it. Oh, usage. Oh. Take out the M then. Yeah. Yay!
Cool.
There you go, Pat. It is already installed.
Yep, and we already got it. So yeah, you're good. And then as you would import pandas, you have to import it into your notebook so that Python can actually use it. So that's what you would do. And then you can, I really don't remember the pandas deal, but I think it's PD or it's import pandas as PD. Let's see. I'm not gonna spend much time on this. We're already short on time. Anyway, so that's all of that. Really quick, because we only have 7 minutes left. Any quick questions about the desktop? And this is the desktop, by the way. It's literally just a computer, like you're a graphical user interface running on a compute node. It's very, you know, it's a GUI. So like, if you need to do some visualization, this is what you'd want to use. Because on Bash, you can't do any graphical stuff. So let's say you have like a really cool molecular simulation that you want to do, and it has a, you need to visualize the output. You would use this to visualize the output because we can see the graphics on it. This has graphics on it. So anyways, that's that. I'm gonna go ahead and show you CCQDEL. So, I'm going to just delete these guys. So this is a command to deleting things. So let's say we're done with the, whichever, I don't know if that was the Jupyter or the desktop app, but I just deleted a job because I was done with it. So I'm going to do CCQStat again. Cool. And it looks like our MPI prime has completed. So next super important thing, how do we look at our job output? So job output is by default written to your home directory. So your home directory is, well, I'll just show you. So, let's say, so echo home, that's the variable that stores your home directory. So echo, so remember that big capital home, that's your home directory. Another really easy way, and I'm not sure if this will work with echo, but, you can use this squiggly deal. I forgot what it's called. But anyways, this is another shortcut. I use this tilde. One because it's just, yeah, tilde. Anyways, I use the tilde because it's just so much easier than having to type out home. But those are two ways to view your home directory. So we're going to change directory into home. And we're going to do an ls. And what do you know? We got mpiprime.e and mpiprime.o. Now let's see if we did everything right. Let's see. So we're going to look at the output first. Yay, we got good output. So we did four tasks to scan. It's a lot of numbers. And we looked at the largest prime of those numbers. So I guess this is the largest prime of that. It's basically calculating a giant prime number. For whatever reason, but anyways, and as you can see, it ran super quick. This is just a sample job. It's not made to run long, but anyways, there's that. Any questions on job output before I go really quickly to custom images? Okay, cool.
Thank you for asking questions. We're right at, we have about 2 or 3 minutes left. So just the FYI.
Yep. No, I know. That's why I'm going to go really fast. We're not going to be able to do everything quite, but I'll show you. I just want to go over custom images real quick. So your Google Cloud project. So you're going to want to probably add custom images, like custom software, to your CloudyCluster, your cluster. How you do that? So what you're going to do is you're going to search CloudyCluster, and all the way down at the bottom is Marketplace. And once again, not everyone is going to have access to the console. You can just go to me and say, hey, Cole, add me to the project, and then I'll add you to the project with using your Gmail. And then you can do all of this. But so this is our Marketplace. So this is actually how you create the CloudyCluster. You can name it something. So let's say I'll call it like custom. None of this really matters too much because we're just doing a custom image. I really don't even think this, the service account really matters because we're not doing a full-fledged cluster. We're going to go, this is the main thing. So this box right here, image customization mode. So this basically will launch an instance, but it won't do anything. You're not going to get a control instance with all this stuff on it because it won't do anything. It'll just launch an instance and it'll just stop there. So going back to our deal. So we're just going to go ahead and launch that. And once again, you're not going to be able to access CloudyCluster, like your control instance, your control interface. None of this is going to be there. It's literally just going to be an instance. So what you would do then is you go over to VM instances, and if it's up, we'll do it real quick, but it doesn't really matter that it's up. Let's see here. Because of time, I'm just going to do this. So we're going to SSH into it. And that's what I would do for the other one. It's just the other one isn't quite created yet. And I have 1 minute left. You would SSH into it, enter in all your commands, your custom software. So like my original plan was this script installs LAMPS, which is a molecular simulation software. And you know, whatever commands you need, you would run in that instance. You would then save that. You would then stop your instance. So we'll do, let's see if we can quickly stop it. You'd stop your instance, go over to images. We're officially out of time. Go over to images and create a custom image from that instance. Then you'd go here and there's a flag that you can use. The flag is, let's see here. There's a flag, let's see, CCQ sub batch H. There's a flag that you can put that image ID in there, and it'll use that for your compute images. So you only need to start a new cluster. That's one of the really cool things about CloudyCluster is you only have to install it on one instance, and you don't need to create a new cluster. You can just use the Google image ID in your job script or in your command. So sorry, I went a little bit over. Are there any questions? I understand. So I didn't really get to spend enough time on this part. So don't worry, I will work with people throughout the hackathon. But are there any questions real quick before we end?
All right. Thank you, Cole. I want to give you a hand. Thank you so much for going over that with us. Again, I do want to put out there, Cole will be here with us for the hackathon itself. And of course, and a few other personnel from Omnibon as well. And they'll be here to assist tomorrow as well. Thank you again, Cole. Thank you so much. Cole's contact information is on the screen. So, of course, you can email him to ask questions. Or most importantly, if you want to go ahead and get that Google Cloud instance going, you can email Cole a Google connected, Google Suites connected email so that he can go ahead and add you to that project. All right. Thank you again, Cole.
Yep.
So having
thanks.
And give him a hand one more time. Thank you. Now, thanks. Having said that, tomorrow's the day. I know, right? Tomorrow is the day. And so our kickoff, tomorrow we'll actually have two sessions. So we'll have the GitHub and Discord session in the morning, and then we'll have our kickoff tomorrow night. Now, just so I don't mess up time zones, because there are things, there are gifts and men, where there are certain things that people do well and certain things that people don't do well. One of the things I don't do well is transitioning between time zones, because I overthink it every single time. So I'm going to read it. The GitHub and Discord overview will be taking place at 11 a.m. Eastern, 10 Central, 8 Pacific, where we'll go over GitHub and Discord for persons. And it will, of course, be recorded as well. And then tomorrow night, our kickoff will begin at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Pacific, where our HPC in the City, our third annual SC22 HPC in the City Hackathon will begin, where we get to hear from all of our mentors, where they'll be presenting their ideas, and you can actually select which ones you want to participate with. So with that, I'm going to stop the recording and wish you a good day. Thank you all so much for coming.